promise that you didn't keep? Has anyone ever made a promise to you and then didn't keep it? I'm sure that most of us here can answer that with a yes. But the real question I want you to think about this morning is, have you ever sat back and thought about God and what He promised us? What did God actually do to show His people that He was serious about how He felt about them, about how He felt about sin and the world that He created? We will start by looking at the story of Noah. You know, I know most of you know that he built a big boat and was involved in the big flood of 1200 BC or somewhere around that time frame. But the first part of the message, we will be looking through the story of the flood and at the promise or covenant that God had made with Noah and his family and essentially us. The youth will handle the second part of our message. And my prayer is that when we really begin to focus on God's promise to us and understand that no matter how crazy our world gets, that when God makes promises to His children, He keeps them. Let's pray together. Father God, Lord, we just thank You for all that are here in attendance in Your house this morning. Father, we just ask Your blessing on the service. We ask for open hearts and minds, and we also pray for the students as they continue to lead us. In Your name, amen.
Amen.
So we know there's a lot that's happened since the fall of Adam and Eve. You know, the sin has entered the world. They have now been kicked out of the garden. They had two children, Cain and Abel. Cain killed Abel. And we see this snowball effect of sin getting worse and worse. And now the world has become so corrupt that sin is running rampant. And God isn't happy. In fact, let's look at Scripture so we can get a picture of what's going on and how God felt at that moment. So turn in your Bibles to Genesis chapter 6, verse 5, is where we're going to be starting. It will be on the screen. If you didn't bring your Bibles with you, but we do encourage you to bring your Bibles along. Alright, Genesis chapter 6, starting with verse 5. The Lord saw how great the wickedness of the human race had become on earth, and that every inclination of the thoughts of the human heart was only evil all the time. The Lord regretted that He had made the human beings on earth, and His heart was deeply troubled. So the Lord said, I will wipe from the face of the earth the human race I have created, and with them the animals, the birds, and the creatures that move along the ground, for I regret that I have made them. And may God add a blessing through the reading of His Word as we continue on this morning. You know, I read this and I see, and we can see that God is very angry at how sinful the world has become and plans to completely destroy all of creation. I think it's kind of a scary thought that when you think about it, that He's about to scratch creation and do something different. Sometimes I wonder if He really feels that way about today's culture. However, if we look in verse 8, we see that God has a light in His eye. And it says, but Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord. You know, when Adam and Eve made their choice to disobey God and sin entered the entire world, people knew the difference between good and evil. And other than Noah and his sons, you know, they... Most of them were choosing wickedness. Now, this doesn't mean that they were sinless. But what it does mean is they were serving God and doing as He commanded it and instructed them to do. And this is what I love about God and how, you know, and about the way He loves us. He could have easily said that I'm done with these people and He just opened His mouth and said, be gone. And that would have been the end of it for us. We see that God could have just crushed us, the world, and thrown it away and never even flinched. But His love caused Him to think. And God had a plan. And so can you imagine that meeting with the Holy Spirit and Jesus? God just kind of walking in. God just kind of like walking in, maybe put His hands on the table. And, I love them, but they're hurting my head. What am I going to do with them? I mean, I know most of us grand people have done that several times. But as they begin to build this plan of redemption, in became this perfect plan and for the redemption of the whole world. And we will continue to see this as we go through this morning. So let's keep reading in Genesis chapter 6. We'll be back starting in verse 9. This is the account of Noah and his family. Now Noah was a righteous man, blameless among the people of his time. He walked faithfully with God. Noah had three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Now the earth was corrupt in God's sight and was full of violence. God saw how corrupt the earth had become, for all the people on the earth had corrupted their ways. So God said to Noah, I'm going to put an end to all people, for the earth is filled with violence because of them. I'm surely going to destroy both them and the earth. So make yourself an ark of cypress wood. Make rooms in it, coat it with pitch inside and out. This is how you are to build it. The ark is to be 300 cubits long, 50 cubits wide, and 30 cubits high. Make a roof for it, leaving below the roof an opening 1 cubit high all around. Put a door in it, and the side of the ark make lower, up, or middle and upper decks. I am going to bring floodwaters on the earth to destroy all life under the heavens, every creature that has breath of life in it. Everything on earth will perish, but I will establish my covenant with you, and you will enter the ark, you and your sons, and your wife, and your wife, and your sons' wives with you. You are to bring into the ark two of every living creature, male and female, to keep them alive with you. Two of every kind of bird, of every kind of animal, of every kind of creature that moves along the ground will come to you to be kept alive. You are to take every kind of food that is to be eaten and store it away as food for you and for them. And Noah did everything just as God commanded. So we see Noah is about to build a boat that's never been built. And there's going to be rain, and it's never rained before. And so I think that we can really see that this is a true example of blind faith and trust in God's plans. You know, we see for the first time in verse 18 that the covenant had been made between God and Noah. And the definition of covenant means an agreement, bond, or promise. And so Noah has done everything that God has commanded him to do, and now we see that it's time to enter the ark. Up until this point, it hadn't rained, so we can only imagine what the people thought about Noah and his family. You know, they're probably being ridiculed and laughed at, and they've probably been known that they are the craziest people on this block. And so you can only imagine what was been going on during this whole time frame. And this was a lot of years it took him to build this. And so, alright, let's flip on down to chapter 7, starting in verse 13. On the day that Noah and his sons Shem, Ham, and Japheth, together with his wife and the wives of his three sons, entered the ark, they had with them every wild animal according to his kind, all livestock according to their kinds, every creature that moves along the ground according to his kind, and every bird according to its kind, everything with wings. Pairs of all creatures that had breath of life in them came to Noah and entered the ark. The animals were going in, male and female, of every living thing, as God commanded Noah, and then the Lord shut him in. You know, I love that last sentence. The Lord has shut him in. So I think it's a pretty safe bet there ain't no getting off this ride that's about to go down. I think like those theme parks, you know, you actually stand an hour in line and you get on there and then they come along and then up, that thing slams shut over top of you and you start moving. I don't care how scared you are, you ride. That's why I don't get in those lines. And so, now here we have Noah and them. They're on the ark and this is, and the rain is starting to come. And I started thinking about, you know, what could have been going through their minds, that Noah and his family. I mean, they have no proof that they're going to see tomorrow. No proof that they're going to make it. All they have is God's promise to get them through what seems to be an impossible journey. Have you ever faced a situation that seemed impossible? like there was no way out of the situation that you're in? Well, there is. And his name is Jesus Christ.
Amen. Amen.
God made a promise to Noah and his family. Noah, however, had no idea what the outcome was going to be, had no idea how it was going to turn out. But he was going to have to trust in a God whom he had never seen, and he was going to have to just believe. Noah and his family has been on this ark for about a year now. And can you imagine what that would have been like? What they would have seen and smelled, and I'm sure there were disagreements, and you know, it would have been a very tough year. And I wonder what their thoughts were about the promise that God had made them. I wonder if it helped keep Noah and his family to stay focused on the end result of being saved. It had to be difficult to only see water surrounding them and no way to do anything else but wait it out. Everything was in God's hands. And then in chapter 8, you know, as Mark does, he gives you homework. And so I'm going to give you homework too. You need to go back and read through all this because there is a ton of information during this story. But read chapter 8 because it really just talks about you know, as God prepares them to come off the ark. The water is beginning to recede. He sends out the doves, you know, and a couple times they come back, and then once it comes back with a twig, and then you know, finally it doesn't come back at all. So he knows it's safe to, that they can come off the ark. And so let's pick back up in chapter 9, starting in verse 8. And it says, then God said to Noah and to his sons with him, I now establish my covenant with you and your descendants after you and with everything the living creature that's with you, the birds, the livestock, and all the wild animals, all of those that came out of the ark with you. Every living creature on the earth, I establish my covenant with you. Never again will all life be destroyed by the waters of a flood. Never again where there be a flood to destroy the earth. And God said, this is a sign of my covenant I will make between me and you and every living creature with you, a covenant for all generations to come. I have set my rainbow in the clouds, and it will be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. Whenever I bring the clouds over the earth and the rainbow appears in the clouds, I will remember my covenant between me and you and all living creatures of every kind. Never again will the waters become a flood to destroy all life. Whenever the rainbow appears in the clouds, I will remember the everlasting covenant between God and all living creatures of every kind on the earth. So God said to Noah, this is the sign of the covenant I have established between me and all life on earth. So the covenant comes full circle here. God wants Noah to remember that the promise he made, and so he sealed it forever. God uses the word covenant around 7 times in these last verse, in these verses, to reaffirm his commitment to Noah. Not only does God use the word, he also follows it up with the sun in the sky. The rainbow was created as a visual promise of God's grace and love for each of us. And God was making sure his people would never be able to forget that God doesn't break promises. This wasn't the only time that God made a promise to his people. Our faith rests secure in the promises of God. As I did my research on this, I found that there are over 7,000 promises from God in the Bible. However, there is one significant time in history that is the utmost importance to those who believe in Christ. Just as Noah believed in a God that whom he couldn't see, we have a God, or we believe in a God whom we have record of being on this earth.
Amen.
And we can see those promises come to life even today. However, for some, just as in Noah's day, they didn't believe that there was a God. And there are those today who still reject Christ's promises. Now, the youth have prepared a script to teach us of God's unconditional love for the people who are full of sin. This would lead up to the final part of God's plan of redemption for all mankind and to make the greatest promise in all history.
is the day of unleavened bread, which the Passover lamb will be sacrificed. Peter and John, go make preparations for us to eat the Passover.
Where do you want us to prepare for it?
As you enter the city, you will see a man carrying a jar of water. Follow him to the house which he enters. And the teacher asks where his guest room is. He will show you a room that is fully furnished. Go there and make preparations for us to eat Passover.
Yes, Lord.
Father, the hour had come for me to leave this world and come to you. I know you have put all things under my power, and that I came from you and am returning to you. And that I love these my disciples to the, in the world and love them to the end. Call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so. And that is what I am. Now that your Lord and teacher have washed your feet, you should also wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example that you should do as I have done for you. Very truly I tell you, no, not the servant is greater than his master, nor is the messenger greater than the one who sent him.
Lord, King of the Gentiles, lord it over them, and those who exercise authority call themselves benefactors.
You are not to be like that. Instead, the greatest among you should be like the other, and the one who rules like the one who serves. For who is greater, the one who is at the table or the one who serves?
The one who is at the table.
But I am among you as one who serves. A new command I give you. Love one another. Love one another. As I have loved you, and you must love one another. By that, everyone will know that you are my disciples. If you love me, if you love one another, then you know that these things, you will be blessed if you do them. I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it. It will not find fulfillment until the kingdom of God comes again. You know that I've stood with me by my in my trial. And I confer on you a kingdom just as my Father conferred one on me. Thank you. sit among thrones, judging the 12 disciples. I am not referring to all of you. I know that those I have chosen. It is to fulfill this scripture. Who is with me has betrayed me and has eaten my bread. I am telling you before it happens so that when it does happen, you will believe that I am who I say I am. But the hand of him who is going to betray me is with mine on the table. The Son of Man will go as it has been decreed. But woe to that man who betrays me.
Ask him which one he means.
Lord, who is it?
It is the one to whom I will give this piece of bread when I have dipped it in the dish. What you are about to do quickly. Now the Son of Man is glorified, and God is glorified in him. If God is glorified in him, God will glorify the Son himself, and glorify him at once. Thank you, Father. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Thank you, Father. This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. Take this and divide it among you, for I tell you, I will not drink again from the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. My children, I will be with you only a little longer. You will look for me, just as I told the Jews. I will tell you now. Where I am going, you cannot come.
Lord, where are you going?
Where I am going, you cannot follow, but you will follow later.
Lord, why can't I follow you now? I will lay down my life for you.
Will you really lay down your life for me? Very truly I tell you, before the rooster crows, you will disown me three times.
Lord, I am ready to go to death and to prison with you.
I tell you, Peter, before the rooster crows today, you will deny three times that you know me. Simon, Simon, Satan has asked to sift all of you as weak. But I have prayed for you, that your faith may not fail. When you have turned back, strengthen your brother. When I sent you without purse, bag, or sandals, did you lack anything?
Nothing.
Now, if you have a bag, take it, and also a purse. If you do not have a sword, sell your cloak and buy one. And it is written that he was numbered with his transgressors, and I tell you that it must be fulfilled in me. Yes, what is written about me will be fulfilled.
See, Lord, here are two swords.
No! You're not to be like that. Don't let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have said that I am going to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to where I am. You know to the way to the place where I am going.
Lord, we do not know where you are going, so how can we lead the way?
I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really know me, you will know my Father. And as well, from now on, you do know him and have seen him.
Lord, just the Father will not be enough for us.
Don't you know me, Phil, even after you've been with me such a long time? Anyone who has seen him has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? Don't you believe that I am in the Father, and that the Father is in me? And the words I say to you do not speak on my own authority. Rather, it is the Father living in me who is doing his work. Believe me when I say that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me. or at least believe on the evidence of the works themselves. Very truly I tell you, whoever believes in me will do the works I've been doing, and they will do even greater things than these, because I am going to the Father, and I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. You may ask me for anything in my name, and I will do it. If you love me and keep my commands, I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to help you along the way, the Spirit of truth. The world cannot accept him because it neither sees him nor knows him. But if you know him, for he lives with you and will be in you, I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. Before long, the world will not see me anymore, but you will see me. Because I live, you will also live. On that day, you will realize that I am in the Father, and that you are in me, and that I am in you. Whoever has my commands and keeps them is the one who loves me. And one who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I too will love them and show them myself to them.
But Lord, ready on him to show yourself to us and not to the world.
Anyone who loves me will obey my teachings. My Father will love them as well, and we will come to them and make our home with them. Anyone who does not love me will not obey my teachings. These words you hear are not my own. They belong to the Father who sent me. All this I have spoken while with you, but the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid. You heard me say, I am going away, and I am coming back. If you loved me, you would be glad that I am going to my Father. For the Father is greater than I. I have told you now before it happens, so that when it does happen, you will believe that I am who I am. I will not say much more, for the prince of this world is coming, and he has no hold over me. But he comes so that the world may learn that I love the Father and do exactly what my Father has commanded me. Come now, let us leave.
So as we have seen and heard today, God loves us despite our many flaws. Even when we mess up, he still loves us. He reminds us that when he makes a promise, he keeps it. And we can take that to heart. You and I will fail. You and I will let each other down sometimes, even when we don't mean to. However, God will never fail us. He will never let you down. He will always be there to remind us of his love. We need to remember that God gave his only Son to die in our place for our sin debt. And I think that's pretty awesome. God's plan for us is always perfect. Doesn't mean that we won't experience hard times, or experience tragedy or loss, but we will know that the end result is always beautiful. So as we move into closer to this Easter season, we really just need to think about God's promise, never to break a promise. There are several scripture verses that tells us of God's promise to always be there for us. But one of my favorites, and I wanted to share, was Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you, not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. God has your back. Let's pray. Father God, Lord, as we went through this morning, Lord, we see we're not flawless. But Lord, we do things because we want to please you. And Father, we just know that you're always going to be there to pick us up when we mess up and when we fail. And Lord, we just ask that you just continue to be with us this morning during this time of service. And Lord, if there's anyone here that don't know you, let today be their day of salvation. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
I'd like to have Pastor Mark come up and be with me. If there's anyone here that, you know, as I said, if you don't know Christ, you know, don't leave without knowing his promise to you, that he loves you and he wants the best for you. Yes, nothing that you could have ever done in your life that would ever turn you, for him to turn his back on you. So, if you don't know, come and talk to Pastor Mark and I. We won't embarrass you. We just have a prayer with you. And if you're struggling with something, you're just going through tough times, come up and have prayer with us. The altar is open. And it's, just come and have it and just pray. And if you've been coming for a while and you haven't joined yet and you're looking to say this is your home church, we'd love to have you. If you need baptized, we'd love to have some baptisms. And we're all the time, let us open the doors and say, here it is. And in the famous words of Roland, come on in, the water's fine. So whatever's on your heart or mind this morning, just come and talk to us and have prayer. So let's stand and sing.